first to thank the organizers to giving me the opportunity to speak at this Kosao Jamboree, which seems to be having a very promising future. So I was thinking of suggesting a possible future venue of this event, but I realized that the competition is very strong. The bidding process is comparable only to bidding to host the World Cup. I hope this is the only analogy.
Are you driving?
So, what I would like to discuss today is something that I have learned from my collaborator, Mark Ballard. Since I'm notoriously a slow and terrible learner, as this walls and many people in the room can testify to, so I'll just do one example here. This talk will be very slow, please bear with me. So the plan is I'll do this degeneration. I'll just do one example, and if the time permits, I'll mention another one, which I learned from mainly from Andy, but it's part of the work of Andy with Nitzke, with Gaiotto, and Moore. So let me start with this example. So let's say that I have P1 plus P1. And so I embed this algebraic surface using the Segrain C3 system in P11. So basically, this means that I use all polynomials of degree 2 in the first two variables, and all polynomials of degree 3 in the second two variables. So we have 3 times 4 itself, minus 1 is 11. And so what I'll do with this surface is consider a certain degeneration of it to union of planes. Each of these triangles here represents a P2. And then these P2s intersect over lines represented by these lines that we have here. So altogether, as you can easily compute, the degree of this embedded surface, embedded P1 cross P1 under Segrain bearing is equal to 12. So we have 12 triangles. And so now I'll put additional data into this picture. So I want to put here a curve of type 2-3. In other words, this is a homogeneous polynomial, which is of degree 2 in the first two variables, and degree 3 in the second two variables. So this defines for me a smooth Riemann surface for generic choice of this polynomial of genus 2. And then if I kind of represent this surface on this picture, I get something like that. And so what I want to do now is to study the possible degenerations of this surface as a part of this P1 cross P1. And then try to see how these degenerations relate to each other. So this is a genus 2 curve. And so let's look at the two points in the moduli space of degenerations that we've got. And so let's say that the first cusp actually corresponds to the then the second degeneration associated with the Bowen curve. Which means that I picture here and keep everything else the same. And so what we have is one of these master spaces which appear in the work of Morelli and Bogdanovich, which describe all these variational transformation, or factorization of variational transformation in the toric world. So basically what we do here is we start with this degeneration, and we change it to one. So as I said, I keep everything else the same. So this embedded degenerations started already was described to me by Kapranov, Delphant, and Zelivinsky, and appeared in the works of Schunkel and Bilera before that. But so what we want to do now is to look at them from this perspective. So in other words, I have two quadrics. Each of these things represent a quadric. And then I put these quadrics together in a whole P3 family, and this is the way I moved from his degeneration to this one, a Siddenberry curse, which precisely corresponds to this move in the moduli space of genus 2 curves. So this move here actually corresponds to a path which connects these two cusps. And so we, of course, can combine all these possible degenerations together and consider the moduli space of all these degenerated P1 plus P1s with F, namely the genus 2 curve embedded in them, and consider the fundamental group of this moduli space minus this dominant loci. And so the statement is that this fundamental group actually projects on the mapping class group of the genus 2 curve. And so we would like to make some use of this observation. So now, of course, this is a mirror symmetry, string theory conference. So I initially learned, or got the idea how to study the mirror of this genus 2 curve from Kentaro and Kumro. So it was suggested that the mirror of this genus 2 curve is going to be nothing else but in the way Kentaro and Kumro wrote it, the following intersection of two hypersurfaces in this starting field. And we enable this with the potential. Singular, but after we resolve the singularity, we get a family of K3 surfaces. And then the central fiber is an intersection of three surfaces. And the singular set looks like this theta curve, namely two conics and a line which intersect in two points, like that. And so now it was proven by Paul Seidel that the Foucault category, which we want to study today, of the genus 2 curve corresponds to the DB sync of this configuration, almost. And so what I want to talk a little bit now, before moving further, how this degeneration that we have on this side corresponds to the what's happening on the mirror. And so this, of course, is possible to describe. So I start with my curve here. And then what we are going to do is actually fill this line here. In other words, the precision that I'm describing is nothing else but a flow in the language of directional geometry, which initially brings down this curve. And then sort of a blow of this. So in other words, we can think of this as a moduli space of all this degenerated Landau-Ginzburg model. And then I have, at this point, some very degenerated Landau-Ginzburg model, which is basically two lines this way, two lines this way. And then over these walls, actually have these two pictures. And passing through this, I have a P1 here, which parameterizes this marker space. So this passing through the wall corresponds to this walk, but going this way and going back actually defines for me identical transformation. So in a way, this wall crossing here is nothing else but recording the flip which I described on this side. Now these are real walls, and there are many of them. But of course, they propagate to divisors, and so we have the corresponding mirror space here. Which parameterizes all the generated Landau-Ginzburg with models with this potential system. So now, this is the picture that we see from logical mirror symmetry. And so the question that we want to study now is how these walls interact. So I would like to propose a way of doing that. And in order to do this, I need to introduce a certain categorical invariant. And so we move to the second part of the talk, maybe this dimension spectrum. So let's say now that tau is a triangulated category. The category we will be mainly concerned in this talk is the category of the entire category of the genus Hooker, but of course this could be any triangulated category. And so we introduce the following invariant associated with this category. So let's say that I have an object P in this triangulated category. And so I'll denote by bracket E the maximal subcategory, which contains all sums. And so if I have two of this subcategory, so I introduce the following operation. So this is the, again, the category falls under this operation generated by what we have here. Namely, I take U1 in the first category, V2 in the second category, and then here I consider the following extension. And so what I call this extension on this operations, and so this is the result of this operation. And so what I want to define now is that the element E so E is an object in the category is called a strong generator if and only E in power n, which means nothing else but taking this operation n times, is equal to tau, and then we call n the generation time of this generator E. Now, if we take all possible generation times, for strong generators of this category, so this set will denote following or law the spectrum of the triangulated category tau. So there is a lot of work that was done in this direction. So initially, the notion of generation time, as far as I know, was introduced by Rouquier. And he conjectured that the dimension of X, if this is smooth projective variety over complex numbers, is equal to the minimal number of this spectrum, which he denoted as a dimension of the category. And later on, Orlov proved that if X is a smooth algebraic curve, then this indeed is correct. So the dimension of dd of X, which is the minimal number in the spectrum, is certainly equal to 1. So let me give an example, and then move further. So the example that I want to give is the derived category of elliptic curve, sorry for, I'll use this, which of course is equal to the Foucault category of a mirror elliptic curve. And so in this particular case, the spectrum of tau is equal to the following sequence of numbers. And in fact, let me just write the possible generators, which are not unique in any way, which we associate with these numbers. So here, P is a point on the elliptic curve. So the shift force is the structure shift on the elliptic curve, and so O plus O of 3P generates in two steps. So O plus O of 2P generates in three steps, and O plus O of P generates in four. Yeah. But so the spectrum actually is a theorem along with Bach and Rivero. And in fact, this paper contains a lot of emphasis on the importance of the study of this notion of the spectrum. And let me emphasize one more phenomena, which I might be able to demonstrate a little bit later if I get time. So one more example. So this is the category DB sync in C-star with a function z, well, let's say a simple example today. So this is a category which gets just finitely many objects, so everything is pretty much linear algebra, but still some interesting phenomena happen here. So the spectrum of this category, so this is a coordinate of Z, consists of the OM numbers. And so you see that there is a missing number here, so which we denote the gap of the spectrum of DBC. And so let me just for the meaning of this talk, we know this by 2. So it's a difference. And so this gap conjecturally has a very strong connections with the geometry of the manifold we study. So in particular, so let me formulate two conjectures before, just two conjectures before we go back to this. So so if X is smooth projected, and X is birational to Pn, then the gap of dB of X is less or equal to n minus 2. And one more conjecture. So let this X is a smooth projective surface. Then we have the following equivalence, H to 0 of X, not equal to 0, implies that the gap spectrum of dB of X is equal to 2.
So, gap only single numbers?
So yeah, so that's a very good question. So when I say the gap, I mean the maximum gap that appears here. So I mean one of the other conjectures that you have Calabi-Yau, then the gap is going to be equal to generically to n, if the dimension of Calabi-Yau is equal to n, and this is only in the complex case. So if you consider Calabi-Yau, so the type Yau was considering yesterday, so the gaps could get pretty big, and pretty much this is connected with the number of the independent conic fold transitions that you make, so that you move from S3 cross S3 to Calabi-Yau here, consider. All right, so now, how do we compute these numbers? So the main technique, which was developed by Matt Bach and David Palermo, is the so-called Gauss maps, which initially was introduced by Fouquet, Gauss sequences. And so the main observation is the following. that the object in Tao belongs to Jitsu-ben, but does not belong to J-1. It's equivalent to existence of the following sequence. Objects and morphisms such that the sequence is indistinguishable on level of cohomology, on level of comps. And then we have that F1, F2, and so on, Fn is equal to 0. And there is no sequence like that for n equal to, for n plus 1. So let me briefly demonstrate how one gets such a Gauss sequence on our favorite example, the genus 2 curve, and then we'll move to something in the direction. Here is my genus 2 curve, and I choose a basis. So let's try a curve like that is hyperelliptic. So this is alpha 1. And so I construct the following Gauss sequence. So I start with x0. And then I put here x1 defined in the following way. So I take a 10 twist associated with alpha 1 and apply it to x0. So I don't have time exactly to find the morphism, but there I naturally define it out of this picture. So the next one is x2. And so on. So I go up to up to A4, and then I go back. And so now, in order to prove that this is a Gauss sequence, you need to use the following relation of the in the mapping class group of genus 2 curve. So in other words, this example suggests that knowing relations in the mapping class group, or in other words, knowing something about this fundamental group of all the generations, is equivalent to knowing a generator and certain generation pattern. This, of course, was noticed in a certain way by Paul Seidel some time ago and was exploring the work we did with Matt Bard and David Pavel. But so what I want to do is now that So this is a little bit too long of a word, and so we get the cost sequence of length 8 here, which means that generation time of the object this object, namely in Foucault category, I have the sum of these Lagrangians, namely of these loops in the fundamental loop, is actually generating for generation time at least A. And so what we want to do now is to perfect a little bit our calculations of these numbers of this generation time based on this the generations which I have described here. And so what I'll do in the remaining 5 minutes is formulate a couple of conjectures and then see how they might be working on the example that I have stated. So I have this moduli space of pairs and divisor Z here. And over each point I have, of course I can express this in categorical terms, but let's not do this now. The core structure, the mixed core structure of the pair, this is the toric variety in which X is a toric variety in which my curve is embedded, and F is the curve itself. And so the conjecture is that now if I have a generator, I can choose some subspace in here which corresponds to this generator. And then I get a representation of pi 1 of ug minus zg into the automorphisms of this mixed core structure here. And that representation defines a weight-foot ratio on this core structure. And so the conjecture one is that the length of this weight-foot ratio is precisely equal to the generation time of the generator G. So in other words, I choose this UG by the number of the elements which, looking at what elements belong to my generator. And then, so I could choose a subspace in this moduli space which contains this divider, and I consider a representation of just this space, and that gives me this weight filtration. The corresponding post-structure. And so our second conjecture is that there is correspondence between the combinatorics of the generation and the spectrum of, in this particular case, Foucault of this curve. And so what do I mean by that? So here's my degeneration. So here are the main points which define the corresponding bone structure on these degenerations of the Landau-Ginzburg model. So here are the sort of each of these defines a wall, and then this defines two. So if we compute this point, then that is 6 plus 2 is equal to 8. So the maximal degeneration time is computed in such a way that combination of this gives you the other generation time. If this is not 2-3 curve, but just 2-2 curve, we have 4 points. So this is a genus 3 curve. So we have again, the combinatorial structure of the walls can be recorded like that. So we have so 8, and each of these intervals contributes 2. So this calculation suggests the following. That the spectrum of the entire category for genus G curve is equal to the sequence of number between 1 and 40. So once again, so this way to obtain the sequence is basically to study the geometry of these walls in the Nagler space, Landau-Ginzburg model and degenerations, or the modular space in which my genus two curves is related. Of course, this should be a general procedure, and then the geometry of the corresponding Landau-Ginzburg model that we want to study should play a more important role, and the corresponding combinatorial should lead to the gap, but I think that I'm out of time. So let's go here.
Well, let's thank the mill again.